up and stand with us. We're going to sing a song about the house of the Lord. It says that there should be joy in the house of the Lord. So how many of you are glad to be in the house of the Lord today? Say amen. All right. Well, that was okay. Y'all sing with us.
This morning in your house, Lord, we just praise and thank you for the beautiful, wonderful rain that you're sending to water your earth, Father. We just ask that you just keep on sending it, Lord. Just be with us this morning as we come and to worship you, Father. Help us to put everything else aside and just focus on you during this time. And we just ask that you would just send your Holy Spirit to be amongst us, Father, and just fill us up. And just we just ask that all these favors and blessings in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, we're so glad that you're here today. We want to welcome you to the service. We want to remind you of a few things. The announcements that were up there. First of all, though, anyone that's interested in going to the Processing Center for Operation Christmas Child, it's on the 7th of December. We have the sign-up list up here, or you can talk to Roy Ann. We already have, I don't know, 6, 7, 8, something like that, that are going. But if you're interested in going, she needs to know real quick so she can reserve those spots. And it will go up and back in the day, right? All in one day. So sign up for that if you would. Also, Brother Larry has a word about our scripture reading list, so go ahead and share that announcement if you would.
I'm going to put that list out probably on this coming weekend, and not this weekend, the next weekend. And I'm still going to do a rotation, but since we had our deacons ordained and we have them, we'll do a deacon, a church member, a deacon, church member that way. If by some chance your name is on there and you don't want to do scripture reading, give me a call or give Brother Dennis a call, and I'm going to be an alternate. And I'm sure that maybe some others can be as well. So in the process of it, I mentioned before about the list and getting it together. So it'll come out, like I said, not this week, but next weekend. Just we'll keep in touch and go that route. And try to keep the men involved in the church along with the new deacons and keep Jesus happy. How about that?
All right, thank you. All right. Also, we want to remind you of Trunk or Treat, which is going to be Tuesday. Hope that you've already made some plans for that. And it's going to be inside, right? I'm sorry, she's consoling her child. It's going to be inside. I'm going to have her console me when she gets to the house. But we're going to have it inside to kind of avoid the weather. So y'all be in prayer about that. If you can help with candy. Any little activity that the kids can do, we would really appreciate that. And then you can pray about that. Pray that.
Can I just make an announcement?
Yes, ma'am.
If you're planning on breaking the trunk, it's going to be inside. If you'll let me or Charlotte know today, because we're going to set up tables for each.
Okay, for each station. Okay, we're going to set that up today for Tuesday. And that's going to be from 6 to 8 or 6 to 9. Yeah, we're going to make it as, we're going to try not to be there real late. So. 6 to 8. 6 to 8. Okay. We'll see how that goes. We're going to have hot dogs and it's going to be a great time. Speaking of food, right after the service today, we're going to have a hamburger fundraiser, and we want you to be sure and stay for that. I think some of the kiddos are cooking, had made some cookies and, you know, several different things like that that we're going to try to sell. And then that way we can, not sell, but ask for a donation. And that way we're going to be able to buy some Bibles for Wednesday night for each of our classes so that everybody will be able to have a Bible, one thing. And it'll be the same, you know, translation, another thing, and we're going to leave it in the rooms so that they'll have it every time they come. So if you would just help us out with those Bibles, and I don't know if you bought a Bible lately, but they're going up like everything else is. It's just really crazy. But we don't want to get some little paper ones that'll just last a few weeks. We want to get one that will last for a while. So, all right, that's Tuesday. Then we want to remind you about Wednesday nights. We have our classes start at 6, adults at 6. We're studying about Moses, Elijah, and Jesus the Messiah. And Theron is teaching that class here for our adults. And then we have something for each age also. All right. Any other announcements? A ladies Bible study Monday still? Yep.
We are not meeting this week because of the
Oh, yeah, that's right.
But we'll start up again the following Monday. Right. And Susan is volunteered to do a really cool thing for the 5 weeks, starting not Monday, but the next Monday. Do you want to tell about it, Susan? She's going to do a little devotion for us about Advent and, like, preparing our hearts for Christmas season.
Very good.
So I think it's going to be really cool. There's, you know, a little bit of homework if you want it. But it's not, you don't have to buy a book or anything like that.
All right, no book or anything, but that sounds exciting. Not this week, but it'll start the next week.
Correct.
Right? Okay. All right, Monday Men's meets at 6 tonight, Sunday night. Are y'all having life class tonight?
Life group, yes.
Life group is meeting at 6 o'clock in the fellowship hall. A lot of stuff going on first of the week. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
November the 11th, we'll start our men's breakfast back.
Okay.
And things, so.
All right, put that on the calendar, November 11th, men's breakfast in the old fellowship hall over here, okay? Yes. If any of you, we announced this a week or so ago, but if any of you were planning on giving money to our guide and his family that when we went to Israel just recently, we had come up with an idea of sending him some money personally, sending him some help as they live in Israel over there and all that stuff going on. And, you know, not having a job and all of that stuff, that was all taken away. So if you had planned to do that, you need to get a hold of Kara Jeffcoat just immediately, because she's planning to do that real soon. If you don't know how to do that, you can talk to Charlotte. And but anyway, get a hold of her so that you can do Venmo or whatever you have to do and make sure that that money goes to our guy, George, and his family. All right? Let's see. Am I forgetting anything? I did. Oh, yes. Yesterday... we had, what was that? What is it? Fifth and sixth grade? Fifth and sixth grade volleyball team from Bremon won the championship. I mean, for the whole group. And they've been doing a great job all year. We have several here that are on that team, Savannah and Lacey and Piper. No, Piper's softball. Okay, anybody else?
Kylie
Rose, yes.
Carly.
Well, this is the First Baptist team. Would y'all stand up, those of you that are on that team? These guys are champions. So we are so proud of them. Thank you. Thank you. All right, so just encourage them. We got a lot of things going on, football, softball. Our kids are very much involved in all that stuff. All right, so don't forget the hamburger thing right after the service, and we're going to have a good time. All right, anything else? Yes, ma'am.
The volleyball girls won district, and they're going to the playoffs.
All right. High school volleyball. Amen. Wow. We've got champions in this church. All right, let's see. All right. Children's Church, if y'all would come and our ushers come to take our offering, please. Let's pray. Brother Cody, would you please lead us?
Brantley.
Father, we just come before you, Lord, and so grateful and thankful for the rain you've sent us today. We pray that give us a fresh word this morning. Speak to us, Father. Soften our hearts, God. I pray.
Amen.
Everybody just draws closer to you. Jesus.
Amen. Okay, never mind. I thought you needed it to talk on.
Thank you.
Sorry, I got closer. Good morning, guys.
Good morning.
Tell me something. Have you ever lost something that was important to you?
Yeah.
You found it? Your iPad? Yeah. How'd you feel when you lost it?
Sad,
yeah. Well, what about this? Have you ever seen signs like this around?
Yeah.
And how do you think, I mean, I know some of y'all have lost animals before, and some of them came back, and some of them didn't, did they? And so that was even more hard on you, wasn't it? So the story we're learning about today, which I think most of you have already heard many, many times. I lost my place. I'll go right there. Yay, it's still there. I've lost it 3 times this morning. I had to find it again. All right. So we got there. Okay. So in the Bible, Jesus in Luke 15, Jesus is telling the story about a young man who had a wealthy dad, and the young man decided he wanted to go sow his wild oats, and he wanted to go, he wanted half his inheritance. He was going to go off and do his own thing, and his family didn't hear from him forever, and they didn't know if he was dead or alive, so they were really worried about him, right? Like we do when we lose our pets, right? So they were really, really worried about him, but they, you know, they were leaving it up to God, you know. And then at the end, he had already squandered all his money. He didn't have anything left, and he was having to eat the food that the pigs had left over. He was that bad off. And so he decided he'd go back home because even his dad's servants ate better than he did. So he's like, well, I'll just tell my dad I'm sorry, and will you make me a servant in your household? Well, so when he got home, the father was so happy that his son had returned. He gave him a robe, which was really big back then, and placed a ring on his finger, and he ordered his servant. And the ring meant he was still his child. That was giving him family status, not servant. And he said, he ordered the servants to prepare a feast. And he said, my son was dead, and now he's alive. He was lost, but now he's found. Yeah. Jesus told this story to show the kind of love God has for his children. And that's all children, not just you guys, but all of us here. You know, some of us feel like maybe we've sinned too much or we've done too much wrong for God to ever forgive us. But that's not true. God, if you turn to him and turn from your wicked ways, he will accept you back with open arms when you return to him. So let's pray real quick. Dear Father, we thank you for your unfailing love. We are thankful that even when we stray, you welcome us home with open arms. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Okay, we're not done. We have something special that we're doing. You have yours?
I think your mic is off, Lisa.
Hello? Yeah, it's there. Where's Zane? Back there. Where's Zane?
Zane's back there.
All right. I'll just let it. You have one, so I'll let you give that one. Aubrey, are you here?
She's not.
Okay. I'll let you give
she
Aubrey's.
She might be helping cook.
Huh?
She's helping to cook.
All right. And then,
Zane's coming.
Yeah, come on, Zane. All right. If y'all will stand up, go give those to Brother Stan, please. We love Brother Stan very much. And this month is Pastor Appreciation Month.
So
and
much.
The kids were working in the classes, some of them, to make cards for him.
Thank you.
And I guess it was some Wednesday night or something because they weren't all here.
Thank you guys so much. There we go.
Thank you.
Well, thank you for that. I appreciate that. I want to thank y'all for those cards. I'll read them later, and I really appreciate that. I got some earlier too, and it really means a lot to me. I appreciate it.
Okay, the scripture this morning, and in light of everything that's going on in Israel, I want you to read Deuteronomy chapter 31 and 32. And looking at it from this side, it was as Moses was crossed the Jordan River and ready to enter into the promised land. And, you know, Moses wasn't allowed to do that because of disobedience. But God gave Moses a song to teach the Israelite people. And looking at that song from the backside, it reads like a history of the Jewish people. And it talks about the rebellion and how they worshiped other gods and all the things and all the wrath that God has brought on them because of that. And but what I want to read to you, I want you to read that at home, chapter 31, chapter 32 of Deuteronomy. But the last part of that psalm says, "Rejoice, O nations, with his people, for he will avenge the blood of his servants. He will take vengeance on his enemies and make atonement for his land and people." And that's the end of that prophecy. Pray with me, please. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the day. We thank you for the rain that you sent us, Lord. And we just we're thankful for that your word that you allowed to be to last all down through all these years, Lord. It would give us evidence of you and your guidance in this people, Lord, and for us. And we're thankful that we're grafted into the seed of Abraham, Lord, and that you've offered us a way of salvation. And Lord, we just thank you for the way that you take care of us, and just keep opening our hearts today for the things that you have for us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. I'm
right here. All right. Okay, I want to share something really quickly in lieu of Pastor Appreciation Month. I did a little bit of research, and it says that pastors generally stay at a church, if they can choose their church, about 8.2 years. And then pastors who are placed by their religious organization stay about 4.9 years at a church. We have a pastor who's been here 43, and total 52?
Almost 52 years.
Almost 52 years pastoring. Yeah. I want to go to God's word about pastors. And first I want to read out of Jeremiah 3:15, and this talks about God's promise to provide us a shepherd or a pastor for us. And it says, "Then I will give you shepherds after my own heart who will lead you with knowledge and understanding." So this is God's promise that he's, although he gives us our word to follow, that he's also going to give us a shepherd that can lead us in our knowledge and our understanding of God's word. And I thank God so much that he gives us that, because I know that I've called him and asked him several times, okay, what does this mean, or what do I do here? And he always directs me to God's word, and I'm so grateful for a pastor that does that.
Amen.
The next one that I want to do is in 1 Thessalonians 5:12-13. And it says, "Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those who work hard among you, who care for you in the Lord, and who admonish you. Hold them in the highest regard and love because of their work. Live in peace with each other." And we just want to recognize today all the work that you do for the kingdom of God. And I could sit here and list so many things that you do, from things in the church, but then also things in the community. And we have had a funeral here recently that was for a member, or someone who was not a member of our church. And someone from the community said, "So it just seems like if someone doesn't have a church or doesn't have a pastor, that they just call on Brother Stan." And we've said multiple times that Brother Stan's not just the pastor of First Baptist, but he's a pastor of Fremont. Yes. And this community. And he goes outside of these church walls and he lives it. And it's so wonderful to have that example, and we appreciate that. The third scripture that I want to read is in Timothy 5:17. And it says, the elders who direct the affairs of the church well are worthy of double honor, especially those who work in preaching and teaching. And so it's our responsibility as the church to give him double honor. So to hold him in high regard is what the Bible says. And I just want to encourage us to give our gratitude to his service and always lift him up and pray for him and encourage him, because I can't imagine how Satan attacks him daily in the line of work that he does. I know with just this week, I was doing Fields of Faith, and Satan attacked us and the kids so much the whole week. And it seemed like as soon as we thwarted one attack, here came another one. And so I can just imagine the attacks that he faces every day. And I just want to take this opportunity to lift you up and encourage y'all to honor the pastor and to lift him up in prayer. And then the final one is Hebrews 6:10. And this is an encouragement for you, Brother Stan. And it says, God is not unjust. He will not forget your work and the love you have shown him as you have helped his people and continue to help them. So I want you to just keep your eye on God and the blessings that he has for you, Father, that he will not leave you. And he's not unjust, that he's not going to forget that work and the love that you've shown him through helping all of us. So I just want to thank you, and I want to present you with a gift from our church. It's a card and then a token of appreciation, and I just want to present that to you and Miss Debbie for your service. And if I could ask John Mike to pray over Brother Stan, please.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for all our many blessings, and thank you for Brother Stan. We ask that you watch over and care for him for the rest of his days, and keep him with us as long as you possibly can, dear Heavenly Father. And forgive us in any way we will fail you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well,
hold on, Brother Stan.
Oh, we also have one other
thing. Oh.
Made by Christy Luna, and it says, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Psalms 19:14. Also, after the service, we're going to have this in the lighthouse, and we would like for the congregation, if you feel led, to write an encouraging word on the back of it, and we'll have markers and everything over there, so they can hang it in their home or wherever they want.
When I was first called to preach, my mother said, I'm going to get you something for your office someday. I didn't have an office at that time, but she got me a She went to a little bookstore and had a picture made, and on that in that frame was this passage of scripture right here. And that has become my scripture that I want to constantly be reminded of and to try to follow, to let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart to be acceptable to him. And this couldn't be more appropriate. And I thank you so much for thinking about that and doing that. When we went to Brazil, when we went to Australia, when we went to some other places to serve the Lord for a week or so, they would ask me to sign. Sometimes they would ask me to sign their Bible. I mean, it's the closest I got to celebrity, you know. And they would come and they would say, "Sign my Bible, sign my Bible."
And I would always write that Psalm 19:14. I would always write that down under my signature. So my signature is somewhere out there, but this scripture is there. It's not about me. It's about the Lord, you know, doing it for Him. So thank y'all so much. I don't want to say. All right, come on, let's sing.
Save a wretch like me. I heard about him.
almost hear Kevin back there. He was singing. And, no. He didn't want me to say that. Now think about these words, okay?
How could I express?
You know, we just got back from Israel, and so when all this started over there in Israel, it became particularly important for us, you know, those of us that have gone, but it should be important for all of us. And, you know, just to remind us, we have a prayer shawl up here on the front table that's similar to those that those priests wear when they pray. You got the Israeli flag there. But another symbol of Israel is the shofar. Shofar is something that is made from a ram's horn. And it's something that is used primarily in religious festivals and things like that. It was a call for people to gather together before Yom Kippur and some of those holidays that Jews have. And it was something that they would only blow at very special times. But as I did a little research, I found out that the shofar represents a relationship between humans and divinity. It's a symbol of a relationship between man and God. And it's supposed to, as the shofar is blown, it's supposed to stir up a shofar that would be blown in heaven. Of course, we couldn't hear it. That would remind God of his promises of love and mercy and forgiveness and no judgment. And so we're about to sing a song about the name of Jesus. Jesus' name above all names. It's an old chorus. But I just want you to hear. I just want you to hear that shofar blown. Amen. You did good there.
Thank you.
Amen. If you have your Bible, I want you to find in the Old Testament the book of Daniel. The book of Daniel, chapter 5. This is one of my favorite stories in the Bible. Well, I've got a whole lot of favorites. I'm kind of like Carrie that way. I've got a whole bunch of favorites. But this is a really neat story. I hope that we'll be able to give it justice. Kind of covers a whole chapter, so we'll try not to just go on and on. But, you know, sometimes just the Word of God speaks to us louder than what man can. But y'all listen, in chapter 5, verse 1, it says, King Belshazzar gave a great banquet for 1,000 of his nobles and drank wine with them. And while Belshazzar was drinking his wine, he gave orders to bring in gold and silver goblets that Nebuchadnezzar, his father, had taken from the temple in Jerusalem, so that the king and his nobles, his wives, and his concubines might drink from them. So they brought in the golden goblets and that had been taken from the temple of God in Jerusalem. And the king and his nobles and his wives and his concubines drank from them. And as they drank of the wine, they praised the gods of gold and silver and bronze and wood and stone. Suddenly the fingers of a human hand appeared and wrote on the plaster of the wall near the lampstand in the royal palace. The king watched the hand as it wrote. His face turned pale, and he was so frightened that his knees knocked together and his legs gave way. The king called out for the enchanters and the astrologers and the diviners to be brought, and said to those wise men of Babylon, whoever reads this writing and tells me what it means will be clothed in purple and have a gold chain placed around his neck, and he will be made third highest ruler in the kingdom. Then all the king's wise men came in, and they could not read the writing or tell the king what it meant. So King Belshazzar became even more terrified, and his face grew more pale, and his nobles were baffled. The queen, hearing the voices of the king and his nobles, came into the banquet hall. O king, live forever, she said. Don't be alarmed. Don't look so pale. There's a man in your kingdom who has the spirit of the holy God in him, holy gods in him. In the time of your father, he was found to have insight and intelligence and wisdom like that of the gods. King Nebuchadnezzar, your father the king, I say, appointed him chief of the magicians, enchanters, and astrologers and diviners. This man, Daniel, whom the king called Belshazzar, was found to have a keen mind and knowledge and understanding, and also the ability to interpret dreams, explain riddles, and solve difficult problems. Call for Daniel, and he will tell you what the writing means. So Daniel was brought before the king, and the king said to him, are you Daniel, one of the exiles my father, the king, brought from Judah? I have heard that the spirit of the gods is in you, and that you have insight, intelligence, understanding, and wisdom. The wise men and the enchanters were brought before me to read this writing and tell me what it means, but they could not explain it. Now, I have heard that you're able to give interpretations and to solve difficult problems. If you can read the writing, tell me what it means. You'll be clothed with purple and have a gold chain placed about your neck, and you will be made the third highest ruler in the kingdom. Then Daniel said, He answered the king and he said, "You may keep your gifts for yourself and give your rewards to someone else. Nevertheless, I will read the writing for the king and tell him what it means." We're going to continue on beginning in verse 24, but I just want to talk a little bit about what we've just read. I know it was a long passage of scripture, but I wanted us to get a full feel of what's happening here. Nebuchadnezzar was his father, Belshazzar's father, and he was the king just before him. And Nebuchadnezzar was not the king of Israel, was not the king of Judah or Jerusalem or anything like that. He was the king of Babylon. Babylon was the enemy of God's people, and they had captured much of Israel, and they had taken away captives. They killed a lot of people. They left a lot of people there, but they took some of the wisest people and brought them over and trained them up and tried to turn them into Babylonians. And Daniel was one of those. There's a whole bunch of sermons on that. But Nebuchadnezzar had seen the hand of God work through Daniel. And yet Nebuchadnezzar did not learn from the past. And he kind of set himself up as a god, and he wanted people to worship him. And he wanted to set up a replica of himself, and every time people came around, they were to bow down to him. And God came to him through Daniel and told him that you are going to suffer judgment for that. That's not a good thing for you to set yourself up above God. And so Nebuchadnezzar, the prophecy was that he would go out into the wilderness, get down on all fours, and he would live like an animal out in the wilderness. And he literally did that. His fingernails grew so long that it was like that of a hawk or an eagle or something. And he literally ate grass like a cow, like cattle. And he lived out in the wilderness. And I mean, he was completely wild, unable to talk, unable to be the king or any of that. And that went on for a while. But finally it came to Nebuchadnezzar that there he had enough sense about himself that he realized that there was only one God. And that was that Yahweh God that Daniel had talked about. And so he began to worship and to praise the one and only true God. He went back to his palace. He went back to being king. And God gave him a successful reign the rest of the way through, because he ridded the country of all the false gods and stuff, and he just worshiped God, the one and only true God, the Yahweh God. Well, Nebuchadnezzar realized that Daniel was a man of God, and he named him Belshazzar. He named his son Belshazzar. And I mean, you know, he was like a son to him. I mean, it was so important. And he named Daniel, who was a captive from Israel, he named him Belshazzar. And he named his son Belshazzar. And I just thought that was interesting that it was so close. And don't you know that that he knew that? I got that backwards. He named his son Belshazzar. He named Daniel Belshazzar. I got that backwards. But don't you know that was interesting to Belshazzar, the king, the next king after Nebuchadnezzar? Don't you know that was interesting to him? Don't you know that as he saw that his father crawling around out in the wilderness like a wild animal, that had an impression upon his mind? And who he was. Don't you know he remembered the things that Daniel had done, that God had done through Daniel to to speak to the king? Don't you know that he saw all those things? He heard all those things. He knew what his father had finally decreed, that there is only one God, the Yahweh God. And yet he forgot about the past. One of the things I want us to think about is we need to remember our past. Many of you have been raised by godly parents. And if not, I know that they imparted some things to you. I know somebody imparted things to you about God. Maybe grandparents, maybe an aunt or an uncle, maybe a neighbor, maybe a Sunday school teacher. Somebody imparted something about the Lord into your heart and into your life. You've seen people who get up and go to church. You've seen people who serve the Lord. You have seen God work in people's lives. You have seen people pray and God give an answer for that prayer. You've seen that. And I think one of the things that we need to do is remember the past. And I know that, you know, there's things change. And I know that, you know, our world is different from the old-timey world and, you know, back in the dark ages and all of that stuff when I was a kid. But listen, God never changes. And we still, you know, we can learn from the past. He should have learned from Nebuchadnezzar, but he didn't do it. Over in chapter, we're still in chapter 5, but in verse 22, he says, "But you, his son, O Belshazzar, have not humbled yourself, though you knew all this. Instead, you have set yourself up against the Lord of heaven." You knew all this. You knew all about this, but you forgot the past. Listen, friends, many of you need to remember those Sunday school classes when you were young. Many of you need to remember those vacation Bible school lessons that you learned. Many of you need to remember those revival services that your parents made you go to. Many of you need to remember that God has spoken to your heart and life. And it may not be the long ago past. It may be just recently. And some of you might say, "I wasn't raised in a Christian home. I didn't go to school, Sunday school. I didn't go to revivals. I didn't go to vacation Bible school. I didn't go to camp. I didn't do that." But listen, somewhere along the line, somebody has spoken to you. Maybe even as recently as this week, somebody said something to you about the Lord and you go like, "Oh, yeah. I know that that's right. I know that that's right." You know, one of the most terrible things that Belshazzar did was that he took the goblets and instruments that were used in the temple. And the temple on the Holy of Holies, that temple that God had his people build, where the presence of God could dwell. And there were certain things that they would do, and they would use goblets and different things like that. They had to be made of the finest gold. When his father raided Jerusalem, he removed all of that stuff and put it in his coffers. He put it in his riches. And Belshazzar, as he was sitting there, he said, "You know what? We're going to take that gold, those golden goblets, and we're going to bring them out, and we're all going to just party and drink from them," just totally disregarding the things of God. The second lesson I think we can learn in this story is that we need to honor the things of God. You know, one of the things that's happening in our world today, although Jews do not believe in Jesus as the Messiah yet, but they are still people of promise. They are still God's people. And you might say they're like these instruments. And those instruments have been defiled in our day and time. Those people have been defiled. No matter what some of the things you hear on the news. But in our lives, as we try to live our lives for God, we need to honor the things of God. We just need to honor the things of God. We need to make sure that we give the praise and the honor that's due unto Him. God's not so much worried about things, these buildings and all of this stuff, but did you know that in the New Testament it says, "Know ye not that ye are the temple of the living God?" You're the temple of God. And we need to honor and love and take care of people. God said, if you do it unto the least of these, my brethren, you have done it unto me. Or if you've done it not unto the least of these, my brethren, you've done it not unto me. So he was saying, we need to honor the things of God. And we do have the Word. The Word of God. We need to honor that Word of God. We need to study it. We need to know it. We need to read it. We need to make it a part of our lifestyle. Thirdly, I think in this story, we find that God wants us to look to Him for the answer, to look to God for the answer. You know, the first thing that He did, He called in all these astrologers, diviners, and all these nuts, and He brought them in, and He said, tell me what's written on the wall. Can you imagine that happening? As I was reading it, I was thinking it said plaster, the plaster on the wall. We have plaster. Can you imagine what it would be like if a hand came out and started writing on the wall? How frightening that would be. Well, rather than turn to God, he forgot about God. He forgot about what his father had gone through. Rather than turning to God, he turned to all those other guys, and he brought them in, and he said, tell me what this says. Tell me what these words say. You know what? I think out of that whole group of people, probably somebody might have said, I know what it says, you know, eat, drink, and be merry, you know, let's party. Surely somebody said something. But somehow, Belshazzar realized that those guys did not know the answer. They didn't speak the truth. And so he became even more pale. The Bible says he became more pale and more frightened. And he didn't know what he was going to do. So the queen, actually it was his mother, queen mother, came in and said, you know, what's going on here? Your father discovered a man named Daniel from Judah. And Daniel was able to interpret dreams. He was able to solve problems. He was able to do mighty things. They said he had the spirit of the gods. He didn't have the spirit of the gods. He had the spirit of God in his life. They just didn't understand it. And she said, call for Daniel. He'll tell you what it means. Call for Daniel. And he will interpret what is written on the wall. And so he did that. He finally looked to God for the answer. You know what? Sometimes that's all it takes, friends. We might come up against some problems in our lives, some roadblocks, some speed bumps, whatever it might be. We might have some hiccups going on and things that we're trying to do. But listen, the answer is not found in this world. The answer is not found in things of this world. The answer is found in God. And we need to turn to Him. And we need to find the answer there. We need to find it in His Word. So that's what he did. And how did Belshazzar know that what Daniel said was the truth? How did he know? It was something inside of him that told him, this that he's saying is the truth. Listen to it. You know, that's what the Word of God is. It's powerful. The Bible says it's sharper than a two-edged sword. It's able to divide asunder the bone and the marrow. It's able to it's able to cut really to the core, to the truth. It is the truth. And so he listened. We need to look to God for the answer. And then finally, we need to heed the word of God. In verse 24, still in chapter 5 there, well, actually, I'll back up a little bit and read just before that. It said, but you did not honor the God who holds in his hand your life and all your ways. Therefore, he sent the hand that wrote the inscription. This is the inscription that was written. This is Daniel telling Belshazzar what's written. This is what these words mean. Mene, God has numbered the days of your reign and brought it to an end. Tekel, you have been weighed on the balance, on the scales and found wanting. Perez or Upharsin, your God is, your kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. Then at Belshazzar's command, Daniel was clothed in purple. A gold chain was placed on his neck, and he was proclaimed the third highest ruler in the kingdom. That very night, Belshazzar, king of the Babylonians, was slain. And Darius, the Mede, took over the kingdom at the age of 62. We need to heed the word of God. He said, your days are numbered. Your life has been weighed in the scales, and you've come up wanting, and your kingdom's going to be divided. And he did listen to it, because he put the purple, he put the robe, and he put the gold, and, you know, proclaimed Daniel a great man in the kingdom, but he didn't know that that very night he would die. We need to heed the word of God. And I'm not saying we're going to die tonight. you know, God forbid. God, you know, I think that's the last thing that God wants. God wants us to live for him, not to die. God wants us to turn to him, not to continue in our ways and ignore him. He wants us. He has great things in store for each and every one of us. As I look out at this crowd, there's just so much potential. There's just so many great lives. There's just so many wonderful families. There's so many good men and women and young people and children who are really trying to do what's right. It's just, there's so much that God wants to do in our lives. We need to heed the warnings that he gives to us. Let's all stand. Father God, we bow before you. We give you praise and honor and glory and thanks. And we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to hear your word. And Father, as you've spoken to us today, if there's a decision we need to make, may we make that decision today. May we walk down the aisle. May we show the whole church. May we show the whole world who our Lord and Savior really is. God, I just thank you so much for always being there for us. I thank you, Lord, for being patient with us. I thank you, Lord, for giving us a past and people who cared about us and directed us towards you. And I thank you, Lord, for the days when you speak to our hearts through your word and you show us what we need to do. Father, help us to be bold. Help us to be those Christians that you want us to be, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name. Every head bowed, every eye closed. God speaks to you. If there's a decision you need to make, come on. I'll pray with you. Or you may just want to pray by yourself. That's okay. But you come right now. God bless you. It's so good to see all of you. Thank you. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for being here. Don't forget about the hamburger get-together fundraiser, and we'll have fellowship together. God bless you. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Father, we give you praise and thanks for this day, the opportunity to be in your house. God, dismiss us now with your love and just watch over each one. Keep everybody safe. Father, we give you thanks for the rain. Lord, we just give you thanks for that. And you are just an on-time God, just right God. And we thank you for that. God, forgive us where we sin and fall short. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.